Howdy, folks. So on the bench today, we have this. This is a Volvo car audio amplifier. This is a four-channel amplifier out of a 2004 Volvo XC70. And apparently the story goes, this isn't mine, this is my coworker's. Apparently he, or his wife was driving the car after a rainstorm and there had been a water leak somewhere around the windshield. And she smelled a burning smell, and the audio stopped working. And this thing, which lives underneath the passenger seat, obviously went for a little swim. So I don't know what to expect opening this. I'm going to attempt to repair it, because this is a quite expensive OEM part. As far as I know, this is a custom Volvo amplifier. It's not like a rebranded Alpine or anything like that. It had two brackets on the side of it, which make this weird mounting hardware on the sides. I've just taken that off. So anyway, I don't really know what to expect. It could be horribly corroded. Given by the corrosion on the outside, it could be bad. Totally unsavable, we don't know. It could be burnt to a crisp. I have no idea. Being that this is automotive, it could be conformally coated inside. However, given the fact that this is inside the car and not in the engine compartment or anything, I would probably bet it's not conformally coated. Which is unfortunate, because I mean, if it was, it might have survived a bit better. Conformally coating a board does not save it from full submersion most of the time, but we'll find out. So I'm not sure. I hope that this is just two halves that just open up. Oh, there's going to be stuff everywhere. It's a nice aluminum case, though. It's opening, but there we go. I'm afraid that the aluminum has kind of corroded together, and that is not a good sign. Okay. We are in like Flynn. Okay, well, I see some burn marks. Ooh, it's got that smell. It's got the magic smoke smell. God, love that burned silicon smell. Okay, so let me see if I can get this board out, and we'll take a look at it, get rid of this nasty case before it puts any more this flaky stuff all over my desk. It's not corroded to shit, like I thought it would be. I mean, it's got corrosion, but it doesn't look to be as bad as I thought it would be if it was sitting in water as long as I heard it was. So, who knows? This might be savable. So, this was obviously powered on and running when the water was underwater. I'm actually just wondering how easy it is to get this all off, because they're using the aluminum here as the heatsink for obviously all the power devices under here and under here, and obviously whatever this device is here. So there's four of these, and they're all multi-terminal devices, so I can be pretty sure that, because this is a four-channel amplifier, these are probably going to be one per channel, and they're probably integrated pre and power amplifiers. And this one obviously shorted, and it probably took out something else. It's the only visible burn damage that I see, so that's not bad. But I mean, there are ICs and stuff on here. Or are those, yeah. I mean, these parts might be replaceable. I don't know what they are. I wonder how this clip comes off. Let me just figure out how this thing comes apart first. Okay, so I managed to finally get this apart. I had to literally pry these metal tensioners. They've been press fit into grooves in the aluminum housing, and those were not getting out. I mean, I almost broke this trying to pry those out. So yeah, they were in there pretty good. And as you can see, things have gone from okay to not so okay. Obviously, the water pooled on the bottom, and that's why all of the damage, as you can see, is confined to the bottom. But this is, of course, just the housing. What we really want to see is what the electronics looked like. So, from the top, it doesn't look too bad. You can clearly see that that second device there, and actually the first device as well, have had some, they've got some carbon there. But the underside is what tells the true story. And here you can clearly see that we've had a complete trace blowout here. So obviously here we've got our two high current power input, and this one here has completely blown out, and you can hear that. It's just the solder mask is just this crispy, flaky goodness. And the copper actually appears to still be there. It's a bit corroded here in the middle, but the copper is actually still intact. So that trace, I think, is actually still there, so that's not bad. With a track that big, you can always scrape the solder mask off, and then you can solder a jumper on. It's only when you get into super fine traces that becomes a problem. So this would be easy to fix even if this wasn't intact. And we can see it's also quite crispy down here, and it's underneath the pins here. This is where I'm most worried, is that there's some sort of serious trace damage to the PCB here. This looks like copper. Yeah, that's copper. So there are some traces that have blown out here. That's a bit unfortunate. Over here on the end, we've got some more solder mask that's coming off, but the copper seems to be okay. Just some carbon here, that's not, there's no damage there. It's just obviously from the explosion here has obviously charred something over there. Some more corrosion around the edges here. This doesn't look harmful in it. It just looks bad. That should probably clean up okay. And then the only other corrosion on the board is down here. Now this is the power input pins. So we've got our positive and our negative here, and then this is the beginning of the big choke that runs across. I think what I'll do, because this isn't... it's got rust, it's got corrosion, but it's not terrible. If this area is not terribly badly damaged, and these components here are actually sourceable. I don't know what these are yet. I haven't checked. I have to clean the gunk off them first. But if these components are sourceable, and the board doesn't appear to have any massive trace issues, this could very well be salvageable for not a terribly large amount of money. I think what I'd probably do is I'd probably fix up the traces and I'd test these two channels, because these things look fine. So if I can get two channels to work, then I would be safe buying these and fixing the whole unit. But if these don't work, then it's possible that something else has gone. Maybe the control IC over here. This is probably some sort of you notice this. By the way, this is the input. This DIN connector here is the audio input. So there's six pins here. There's front, left, right, rear, left, right, ground, and the center pin is a control pin. So you pull it to 12 volts to turn the unit on, and you can see there's the traces which run over here. So this is obviously the audio, and then there's this one trace runs over here, and this is obviously the control signal, and it runs into this, which probably is a regulator. It's probably an LDO of some kind. I can't read the part number on that, but that's probably, it probably starts this chip here, which is probably a, could be a power supply chip. It most likely is some sort of an oscillator, because we've got these power devices. So what my theory is, we have the 12 volts DC that comes in. This is a switching regulator. So this is a switching controller. This chip gets turned on, when the control signal comes in here, it turns on this LDO, which turns on the switch mode converter, and then we've got these power transistors and probably diodes. So there's probably two diodes, two power transistors, which switch this transformer on at high frequency, which generates a high voltage, which is then smoothed by these filter caps around here, and that's what's used to create the B plus effectively that runs the output stage. That's my understanding of how this would work. So yeah, I'm going to clean this up. I'm going to get an old toothbrush or something and see if I can clean as much of the gunk off this as possible. And then I'll make some more judgments after I can actually see things. So I've just quickly sort of cleaned down the board, and I can't see any other damage that would prevent this from working. I mean, there are bits of corrosion here and there, but nothing life-threatening, with the exception of this. So this is obviously what finally ended this thing. And I wonder how close I can get without the focus going for shit, but we've got the two power traces. Obviously this is one, and then this is the other. And this lower trace right here is gone. I mean, it has completely vaporized right here. So this is not connected anymore, and that's probably why this thing is completely dead, because obviously these two are not working, because obviously these devices have probably blown completely. If you actually look right here, there's a pin that is completely disintegrated. It's completely gone. So obviously these channels won't work, and these two channels over here, even though the devices are probably fine, they won't work because they're not getting a power supply anymore, because this trace is blown out. So that's probably why this thing appears totally dead. So basically, if we could fix this area, replace those two devices, I think we would probably be able to get this working again. Now, the issue I have with that is that this is not just a two-layer board. I've held this up to the light, and there is at least one internal layer. I'm going to assume that this is a three-layer board, because it's so simple, and I can't say if it's three or four layers, but I'm going to say it's probably three. And that poses an issue, because I can fix what's on this side, I can fix what's on the other side, but fixing the internal layers is exceptionally difficult. Basically, you would have to join things by finding where they, because it's through-hole and surface mount, you'd have to find the pins on either side and jumper them with a wire. So it would basically require me knowing the internals of this board, and of course I don't have a schematic, I don't have a layout, I don't have anything. So that could be a challenge. Now, I do have these two channels, and because it's a four-channel amplifier, all four channels are identical. So if I can figure out how these are wired, I should be able to figure out how these are wired. So that could be used to my advantage. So I'm going to look up what these parts are, look up the pinout, and see if I can figure out how they're being connected here. Okay, so I've looked up the amplifier parts, and they are the STMicroelectronics TDA7294s. They're a monolithic amplifier stage, which doesn't surprise me, designed for AB amplifiers. And here is the pinout, and block diagram, all this other stuff that's not really important. The pinout's what I care about at the moment, to see what is and is not there. Now, this is obviously, you can see this is pretty obvious. The positive and negative power supply rails are basically right next to each other, because this is a staggered pitch package. These are right next to each other, on the board, those power pins are right on this end. So it's this pin and this pin right here. So it doesn't surprise me that they've blown out. Not at all. The output is taken right in the middle, and the output is done on the top layer. We have a couple no connects, and then this is where I start getting worried. The mute signal, standby, all these are on the inner layer, and that worries me because I can't see these. I don't know where these are connected to. I would assume that the mute is probably not connected at all. Or it's tied, it's probably tied to a power supply, or tied to ground, because this amp, as far as I know, doesn't have mute functionality. But I don't know if that's needed, and obviously whatever connects to that, it's on the inner layer and it doesn't exist anymore. And the inputs, they are on the top layer, so the non-inverting, inverting, and ground, they standby ground, they are on the top layer. If you take a look here, you can see that they're there. They still exist. So I think what I might do, just given the fact that the inner layer is probably I don't really know if it's really worth salvaging this. I mean, this is like a $350 amp to buy it. What I might do, and this would totally work, is if I can just bridge this power, which is all I should need to do, assuming that none of the other traces run through these pins, I may be able to get these two channels to work, but not these two. I'll just pull these devices out. And, I mean, having two channels rather than four channels is still better than nothing. So, if I can get two channels working, that's great. I mean, these are very common parts. They're very easy to source. So if I can fix them, I will. But I think I'm going to focus on just getting two channels to work. And if I can get two channels to work, then I'll maybe bother with the other two. If I can't get those two to work because something else has gone in here, then I think this is just beyond economical repair. Okay, so we're just gonna power this thing up because why not? So what I've done is I've one way to tell if you don't know the polarity of an input socket, DC input socket, is to find a capacitor, find an electrolytic capacitor. In this case, all the filters on this, these are the input filters, and of course capacitors, at least electrolytics, they're polarized. They have a negative, so you check continuity between the negative of the cap and the pins, and you'll find the negative, or at least the common. So in this case, this is the negative, this is the positive. I've just got a big sealed lead acid battery here, which is going to provide our simulated car battery. And I have also my very, very nice paperclip here. This is in the center terminal, which is the 12 volt enable to bring it out of standby. So basically what I want to do is I just want to hook this up to the power supply. And then I've got my probe, and I just want to see if I'm getting a power supply output here. I want to see if the switching converter is working, the transformer is working, if we're getting our B plus over here. That's the first thing we need. It doesn't matter what else we do. If we don't have a power supply, we don't have jack shit. So I'm going to turn this on now, and I want to do this on camera just in case the thing goes boom, and because I don't get a second chance at this. So I've checked the input resistance, and it's not bad. So don't see any issues here. So let's enable. Ooh. Can you hear that? Can you hear that? I can hear a sizzling. Oh yeah, I can smell that. Yeah, I don't know if you can see that right there. Can you see that right on the side of on the side of this pin right here, you can actually see bubbling from where it's obviously shorted internally, and it's arcing inside the board. Look at that. Ooh. Yeah, this thing was really on fire. Damn. So what that tells me is, disconnect from this from the power supply. So what this tells me is the power supply is at least appears to be working, because we are getting a voltage high enough on the output to arc through. So that's good. That means the power supply probably isn't happy, but it is alive. Obviously with a short, I can't measure the voltage, nor do I want to let that thing run more than just a couple seconds. Because I obviously don't want this to catch on fire or do any more damage. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to desolder both of these devices and see if that goes away. See if the short is internal to these devices. If it's not, then I'm going to have to sort of scrape out this area of the board to try and break that short, which I'd rather not do. So I'm going to get my desoldering iron out and take out those two amplifier ICs. So I forgot to mention, I ohmed out across the output here, and I get about 250 ohms or so. It fluctuates a bit, and that's between this strip of copper here and this trace here. So that's across these two traces. Now, that seems a bit low to me, and when I go onto this side, I pick this trace and ohm it across here, I get the exact same figure. And as far as I can tell, these two traces are no longer connected. So I think something may be shorting, or not shorting, but something is definitely across this. I don't know if I'm measuring the output impedance of the transformer. I shouldn't be, because I'm going through diodes. So I think that might just be the resistance of all this carbon here between these two. So yeah, this could be interesting. So to do the desoldering, I've got this. This is my I don't know how you say this. 474 A++, because it's extra plus. Anyway, this is not a bad desoldering iron. I got this off Amazon, I think, of all places. I've decided to glove up for this because I do not want to get thermal grease everywhere. I mean, I'm literally going to get it everywhere. Regardless, I'd just rather that everywhere not include my hands. Okay, so I've removed the two devices, and it didn't go near exactly as planned because, well, I didn't realize that this board was as far gone as it actually is. It literally disintegrated with any real pressure on it. So that whole section of the board is just ash at this point. Now, the good news is I measured across here and here and here and here and here and here, and it's open everywhere. So whatever that 200 ohm short or carbon resistance that was created by the board is now gone, which means I have it hooked up again and I'm going to do the power up test again. So obviously we're not going to get any power to these devices because it's open here, but we shouldn't get any boiling, you know, arcing going on here, and I should be able to measure the power supply between these two points. And hopefully it's the, I don't know what voltage this runs at, maybe like 70 volts or something. I'm just making a number up, I don't know. So let's see. Hopefully we don't let the smoke out. So I'm going to connect up the main power, but not the signal. So now I'm going to connect up the enable pin. Oh, I still hear it though. Well, actually, I see it right there. I don't know if you got that, but there's actually there's burning going on right down there. Obviously, the inner layers have shorted, and they're burning. Okay, so obviously with the high enough potential that this generates, it's enough to arc across there. Okay, well, I think what I'm going to probably do now is I'm going to probably have to dig that whole area of the board out and hopefully just clear as much of that out as possible. At this point, I'm not really worried about breaking traces because the traces probably don't exist anyway. I just want to clear the short across the power supply and see if I can possibly get these. But every bit further I go, the worse and worse it looks for this. So I've managed to get the massive arcing to stop. When I connect up the power supply, I still get some flashes of light. So there's definitely some arcing underneath in one of the traces underneath this big fat one here. There's definitely some inner layers that are now touching, but it's down to the point where I can measure it without risk of it burning. And when it's running, it's got 52 volts across it, which sounds right. I don't know what this is supposed to be, but just compare with my knowledge of regular home AV receivers and stuff, that seems okay. And so yeah, it's an isolated supply, so I had to connect the ground here because obviously it's on the other side of the transformer, so it's galvanically isolated. Yeah, I'm not really sure what I'm going to do at this point because what I might do is cut this trace here, get rid of this, and basically route out the board. Just take all this out of the board, and then manually bring the traces that I need over. I'm going to look into this a bit more to see where all these go, because I know that the outputs, because the output connector is here, and that they run in on the inner layer through here, and I'm hoping that they go through here and then in, and I hope they don't go immediately down, because if they do, I'm going to cut all the outputs and it's going to get really nasty. So I'm going to just hope that I can cut this part of the board out and then basically rebuild it by hand. That would be the easiest way. But I need to do a bit more investigating first. So I've been doing a bit more digging. I checked, and these two surviving channels are actually the rear channels. These are both the front channels, of course. So what I'm going to do is the rear channels are these two pins here, which you can see, and the ones in the back are the front channel. So what I'm going to do is, I think, because at this point I really don't care, I'm just going to bridge the front and rear channels together. So these two packages will drive the front and the rear channels in parallel. Now I know that's going to have the impedance, but it's not going to be as efficient, but I don't think there's really a big deal about it. I mean, it's not, yeah, it won't be as loud, it won't be as efficient, but it will work, and at this point I think that's all the owner really cares about. I'm doing this just as a favor, so at the end of the day, obviously if he wants a proper stereo amplifier, you know, you gotta just buy a new one, but for basically nothing, just a few hours, I might as well get this at least back up and working again, so that'll be nice. So I've done a little bit more cleaning here, and you can now start to see where some of the traces are coming out of the board. So I need to figure out what I need to cut out of this. I'm gonna basically go on the top, and these traces here, these are the signals from the input DIN connector. So I'm actually gonna get an X-Acto knife, and I'm gonna slice out the front channel, so there's no way that any of this is connected to the input, because of course you don't want to fry the head unit. And I'm gonna cut out as many traces as I can that don't need to be there anymore to try and make this as safe as possible. But yeah, making it safe is gonna be the primary concern I have. And I really don't wanna slice this trace open and get underneath, but I may need to get the Dremel out and just get rid of that whole part of the board and then manually fix them, because I think that's the only way to make this safe again. So I finally lifted this trace, and I think I see that is probably what is arcing to the to everything right there. And I ohmed out that trace that's now exposed, and that happens to be the output of this stage. So that is a necessary trace. We can't get rid of that. Now what I could do is I could cut it out and then run a jumper wire from the output pin, which is pin number 14 here and run it all the way across to the output connector, which is totally doable because it's all pretty easy to do. But other than that, I can't quite see. So, it would have to be something internal to the board that's arcing out. I think what I might do, this might be a better option, is to just get rid of the whole section of the board. And then all I need to run is basically power across, which is 2, and the output back. The input is on the other side, and it runs far enough away from this section of the board. See, it runs all the way over here. So I don't think I'm worried about that, because the input's all the way over here. And the other ones, hopefully they're taken care of by the surrounding circuitry that's local to each module. So that way I don't have to worry about all the mute and bootstrap supplies and all of that other stuff. Hopefully that's taken care of locally, because I don't see any other components on the board anywhere on the other side. So it's all got to be done locally per channel. So I think the only way to make this safe is to get rid of all this carbon PCB material and just route this out. So I think it's time for me to get out my Dremel. So after a little bit of work with the Dremel, this is what we're left with. So as you can see, I cut out this whole section of the board here, and then I scraped off the solder mask on these power traces here so that I can jumper these across as necessary. Now, unfortunately, I just tested the outputs, which are these pins here, pin 14, are no longer connected to any of these pins. So unfortunately, I'm now gonna have to jumper a wire from the output across to here as well. Now I'm worried about the current capability of these outputs, because I don't have a lot of very thick wire. I think I only have like 22 gauge or something. So I may have to search for some wire, or maybe double up on the wire. I'm not sure how I'm gonna have to do it, because I wanna make sure this has at least enough out, at least, you know, somewhere around the right output capability. I don't want the wires melting. I was able to get most of the damaged board. The only little bit of damaged board left is right here, and I don't want to cut this because there's important traces on the other side. So I've just sort of stripped away the power trace with a knife here. And it is a 4-layer board, by the way, now that I've got these nice clean edges, which probably won't be able to focus on, but there are 4 layers in here. So the top layer is now gone, and I can see that there's something on the lower layer, but maybe not the the second layer down. I can't tell. It's either been destroyed or it doesn't exist, and I'm hoping on the it doesn't exist part, because then I don't have to worry about that damage. Otherwise, I got to do some very careful removal of this part of the board, which I'd rather not do. I haven't hooked it up to the battery again, but I'm gonna do that now to make sure that everything's still okay and there's no more burning going on. So I just hooked up the battery and measured across these 2 points here, and we have 60 volts, which is good. Now the thing that I noticed is this does not have a bleed resistor, which means that thing still has 60 volts across it and a lot of capacitance. Enough to melt metal, and that's obviously why this thing failed so spectacularly. But I noticed that when I turn it off, when I take out the enable pin, it drops very slowly, much slower than it did before. Before, I used to take it off and it'd go to like 30 volts right away. So obviously whatever was leaking current in the board is now gone, and it's holding voltage quite well now. I mean, it's been about a minute or two since I had it connected up, and if I just check across, see how much voltage we still have across these 2 points here. Yeah, we still have 59.4 volts. It's barely going down. So I would consider that to be self-discharge of the caps and possibly some dissipation in these devices, because they... Actually, no, sorry, these aren't... What am I saying? Yeah, that would be basically just self-discharge in the caps, and I think that's pretty valid. So I think we've cleared all the stuff away. Now, the big question is, if I bridge the output back, and of course power, will it work? So I'm going to go get some wire, fire up the soldering iron, and make some jumpers. So I managed to find some nice 18-gauge speaker wire, and I've used that to jumper the power across. I screwed up. I made the long one, this one, the short one, this one. Whatever. They're still long enough. Good enough. And on this side, I decided this was the easiest way. So I scraped some solder mask off the traces for the output, and I ran those down to the actual lugs of the connector. And then on the other side, I just bridged the front and rear of each together. Now, I don't actually know if this is left and this is right and vice versa. So it may be that the stereo is reversed. Worst case scenario, if this connector is really designed in a stupid fashion, that they've done left on then on this side and then left on this side, and they've done that, then the stereo is going to be totally wrong. But I highly doubt whoever designed this connector is that weird, but you never know. It's the automotive industry. So I've got that jumper together. So at this point, I am going to power it up and see. I'm going to check DC offsets on the output now that I know it is actually hooked up to the chips, and if everything looks good, I will get out a signal generator of some kind, feed in a 1 kHz tone, and see if we get any output. So here it is, the moment of truth. Let's plug it back in. So first gonna apply power to the DC to DC, which should not do anything. Okay, so that's good. So now we're going to fire up the DC to DC, and we're going to get 60 volts across there, and let's see what happens. No explosions. I like that. That's good. Okay, so I'm going to leave this on now. And get my voltmeter out. And we'll see what we got across here. We have 50.6 volts. Hard to do this and hold the camera at once. Yeah, so 50 volts across there. So that's good. So it appears to be working. And now that I've turned it off, let's see how quickly that drops down. And I'll measure it on this side, because might as well. Volts. Yeah, so these were definitely dissipating some energy. So that's good. So I am going to get a signal source. I'm not sure what I'm going to use for that. Maybe an old cell phone or something. And get the scope out and see if we can see anything on the outputs. So I've got out my scope and I've connected that to the output of one of the channels. I've got no input right now. And let's see what happens when I plug it in. So we got a tiny little bit of blip, and it's settled back down. Looks perfectly normal, no weird spikes or anything like that, so that channel looks okay. Let's swap that over to the other one. The grounding for the speakers is actually common, by the way, so I don't have to move the ground if you're wondering. And the other side. Power's on, everything looks fine. So yeah, so I'm happy with that. So I think it's time to put a signal in. And to do that, I've got this. This is a super old Techniques radio receiver here. Doesn't have an antenna on it, so it's not really picking up anything. But that's not really important. I just need some sort of changing signal roughly at this level. So I might actually just shove some wire into the back. Actually, it looks like it's got a lock. Good enough for now. I gotta hook it up, though. Okay, so I've hooked up the tuner here, and I've tried both the channels and all four of the inputs, and I get really nothing changing on the scope. I'm down at 200 millivolts per division, so you're just seeing the noise floor at this point. So I can't get anything out of it, but when I connect and disconnect, I get some spikes and stuff. So I think there may be some more lines severed than what I thought. I also connected up a small headphone amplifier to try and boost the signal to see if it might have been just a line level issue. That doesn't appear to be it, although it only puts out 3 volts. So I mean, it's not a super high voltage swing. So I mean, I don't know what the input of this is supposed to be. I'm going to read the data sheet and see if these things need a big swing, like basically they need to be preamplified or not. Because I'm not sure. I would assume that's not the case. I would assume they just need a basically like a RCA phono level input, and we should be able to see something. But I'm not seeing anything. So I think they may still be in standby or something. I'm going to probe around the pins and see what I find. So I've got the scope connected to the output of one of the channels, and I've got my probe connected to the tuner, and none of these pins here work, but if I connect my probe directly to the inverting input of this right here, we get an output, and that is indeed the audio station. And the weirder part is, listen. The current draw, the gulps of current that this digital, because this is a digital DMOS amplifier, it takes gulps of current from the DC to DC, and it causes the transformer to vibrate with the music, and you can sort of make out when people are talking and not, just from the vibration of the transformer in the power supply. That's kind of an interesting side effect. Now, that is this channel, and that works fine. This channel does not. So I'm going to have to figure out why that doesn't work, and I'm also going to figure out why the input doesn't go all the way across, because I purposefully avoided the traces that the input took. So obviously there's something else. Or maybe I read it wrong. I've got to flip the board over and find out what's going on. But we have audio out of at least one channel, so that's good. So I just flipped the board over, and it didn't take me more than 10 seconds to figure out why that one channel doesn't work. Doh! This is ground. It's got to go there. So, I've actually been shorting the output to ground on that one. Well, hopefully it's got good protection built in, or otherwise that one might be fucked. Well, I'm gonna swap that over and try it again. So I've just flipped that connector around, and what do you know? If we tap the inverting input of the first channel, we get our audio. So now both channels work when I feed a signal directly into that input. Now, I don't know why this won't work, why I can't get a signal from here, from the DIN connector in. That doesn't work, and neither does the other one. So I'm not entirely sure why. Now, I've metered it out, and these two pins, 3 and 5 on the DIN connector, they go to this side of these input caps, and there is a connection between them, and I can put the signal here. Of course, it doesn't do anything because it's the same as putting it in over there. I can put it on the outside, but that doesn't do anything either. So I'm not quite sure. I'm gonna look in the app notes, possibly for a schematic that might tell me what's going on. But, I can't figure that out. So, I've been trying everything I can think of, and I found in the datasheet there's an app note, and they're not using the exact circuit values, but they're using the exact circuit in the app note. A couple of values are slightly different, but they're the same with between the two channels. It's not like a component's gone out of value or something. I've checked every trace, every component. They're all there. They're all connected correctly, all the way back to the connector. So my thought is that maybe this either requires a speaker, like it requires a load, because it has a feedback from the output. So, I mean, it either requires a load, which is strange, but okay, or it's a high-level input amplifier, because I know in some cars, rather than using low level like RCA jacks, they use basically full level outputs. And the one thing I noticed was this amplifier has a power supply for the output, which is plus and minus 25 volts. That's what gives us the 50 volt supply. And it's also got a supply for the input signal, which is also plus and minus 25 volts, which makes me think that the input signal needs to vary between, you know, plus and minus 25 volts, which is would mean it's a high level input. So it sort of doesn't really amplify, it just injects power basically. And I've put signals as large as 12 volts into it and I can't get it to do anything on its normal input. So at this point, I'm just gonna give it back to my coworker and have him install it in the car and see if it works. I mean, it's not gonna damage the car. I've checked, there's no DC offsets, there's nothing going back to the inputs, so it's totally safe. But yeah, I can't get it to work outside the car, which is really strange. But yeah, I think now I've got to clean this, and I've got to clean that nasty, nasty aluminum box the thing came in. And then I'll put it all back together. I'll probably put some... I don't have any Kapton, unfortunately, but I'll have to put something on this so it doesn't touch the bottom. It might actually be suspended. I might not have to worry about that. But yeah, I'll probably put something down just in case one of these comes off. Just look at that. Yum. So there we are, all back in its case. Just gotta put the lid on. Got the clamps on to heatsink the devices. So yeah, I'm gonna give this back to him. And if you don't see this project again, then it means everything went fine. But if it doesn't work, I'll probably bring it back to the bench, because if it truly doesn't work, I'm seriously curious as to why. So I will take another look at it. But yeah, if you don't hear from me, it's working fine. So hope you enjoyed that. Thanks for watching.